go. My name is Frank Alicia Ford. I'm the Associate Artistic Director here at Diversionary.
Hey.
Good evening. My name is Skylar Sullivan. I am the Director of Education and Outreach here at Diversionary. We are so pleased that you are here. We're so pleased that you're here with us in person to experience some amazing live theater with Stonewall Live 22.
So before we dive too deeply into our evening, I do want to take a moment to acknowledge that we are all currently gathered on the land of the Ipai Tipai, also known as the Kumeyaay Nation. And we as an institution pay a lot of respects to the elders of those communities, both present, past, present, and future. And for more information on the work that we are doing as Diversionary to make theater a fully safe space for all people, regardless of where you look like, what language your mom speaks, or what color your skin is, go online. Or talk to me about it, because I love talking about it.
Also, a couple of things for housekeeping tonight. If you could please reach inside and grab your phone or any devices, make sure they are turned all the way off so that we do not have any disruptions that might take away from the magic of live theater. So please make sure your phone is completely off. Please note the emergency exits on either side of the theater in case we have some trouble. We're located right over here and over here. We do ask that you please keep your mask over your nose and mouth throughout the duration of the performance, which will be about an hour and 10 minutes without an intermission. A special hello to everyone who's tuning in online tonight. We are streaming the event live. And after the performance, if you're looking to talk to one of the cast members or talk about the experience of watching the show, we'll meet you downstairs in the cabaret. They will not be out here. They'll be downstairs, so join us down there after the show.
Speaking of cabaret, you've all seen that beautiful space we have down there. That is a brand new artistic space for Diversionary that is open to the community six nights a week, with a lot of really exciting things going on, from piano bars to a really exciting burlesque show we're having at the end of the month. So check out our website and see what's going on there and come hang out with us sometime. We are also having our gala on April 2nd at the US Grand Hotel. So if anyone feels like donning your best disco gear and having a dance-off with Skylar and I, feel free, we will be there. So for more information on that, ask any one of us, check out our website online. But enough of that.
Right, I forgot to tell you about what's happening here tonight. So, the Stonewall Salon, if you're not familiar with this program, it's one of our seven educational programs we have here at Diversionary. It's completely free for the participants as well as the public who comes to see the show. We create a space where the elders of our LGBTQ+ community can come and learn the skills to express themselves and tell their authentic stories. And that is what you're about to see tonight. Everything you see tonight has been created by the ensemble, with the exception of the final number is a mock-up of a number from a Broadway musical, but that has been re-envisioned by one of our cast members, and you'll see how that works. But everything was created by them and co-directed by Frankie and I, and we couldn't be more proud of what's about to happen here on the stage. If you like what you see here today, please tell your friends about it, because your word of mouth press is the best way we can spread the word. So thank you for being here, and thank you to all of our donors, and as well as the Conrad Prebys Foundation for making this possible.
Enjoy this really delightful evening you're about to get into, and help us welcome the cast of Stonewall 22.
Came out to me. She was 24. I was shocked. I was surprised. My thoughts were, she's chosen a difficult life. She won't have a husband, two incomes, children. She may not make enough money. She may not be able to get a decent job. She may not have enough income to have children, and I know how she loves children. People may say nasty, derogatory things to her. She may be in danger. I was afraid for her. I was sad. My surprise was, she's still the same Elizabeth, bossing me around. She's smart. She knows everything. She's going to tell me what to do, and I better do it. I could understand her feelings because I've had bisexual encounters in the past. And I told her that. I was happy to share that. She then introduced me to her girlfriend and some other girls. And I was happy. She had a community. And then we all went out to dinner. And at the restaurant, a stranger, an older man, came over to us and said, "How nice to see a family so accepting." We were accepting. My family and my future husband's extended family, we were all accepting. Some of Elizabeth's friends were not so fortunate. Some of them were ostracized by their family. And some of the friends were envious of the good feelings that Elizabeth and I had for each other and the closeness that we had. So then, one day, Elizabeth said, "Would you like to go dancing with me at The Flame?" The Flame was a dance nightclub on Park Boulevard. The sign is still there. It was mostly males, but they had women-only nights, and the women there were not all youngsters. There were some older people, and we went, and I decided to take my own car because I wanted to be able to leave when I wanted to. So we went there, and when we got close, I heard the music. It was loud and dancey. And a woman came over to me. She was in her early 50s, attractive. She was wearing jeans and a tight t-shirt. And she said to me, "I wonder, would you like to dance with me?" I said, "Absolutely." So we went to dance. Wanda said, "Can I buy you a drink?" "No, dummy, me." I said, "Of course. I'll have a Cosmo." This was the 80s. So we went to the bar, and Wanda told me all about herself. She said, "I come from money. I've been well-to-do all my life. I'm a giving person. I'm a professional caregiver. I go to people's homes and I take care of a new mother and a baby or somebody who's recovering from surgery. I make a good living, I'm well paid. In fact, I'm rich." I was in a relationship with a younger woman and she just broke up with me. I paid her college tuition. I bought her a new sports car. I paid her bills. And then Wanda said to me, "Would you like a wife?" I was shocked. I couldn't speak. I couldn't speak. Nobody had ever offered to take care of me. I've been working since I'm 10 years old, and at that time I had a new law practice. No one had ever offered to support me. And I was thinking, never mind the intimacy. She wants to make dinner and do my laundry. So, but I was in a relationship. So I said to Wanda, "You're so attractive." I was holding her face, "and so sweet. And your offer is so tempting. But I'm in a relationship. So there can never be a romance between you and I." And I turned to leave, and I waved goodbye to Elizabeth, and Wanda said, "Can I walk you to your car?" And I said, "Sure." So we went to my car, and we shared a sweet kiss. And then as I was walking, I was thinking, I'm so glad I could tell Elizabeth that I had a bisexual encounters years ago. I'm so glad that I can share her community. That's my community as well. That's a gift for me. And as I was walking, I was thinking and thinking, and then I thought, but she's rich!
Hello, I'm Jack, a non-binary person who spent my whole life desperately hiding the fact I'm non-binary. From the time I was very young, I wanted to be a girl. I knew it was wrong to feel that way. I hid it from everyone, including my family. The worst fear of my life was that someone would find out. In my 20s, I was studying for a PhD in computer science at Johns Hopkins. One day, my girlfriend noticed some mascara on my eyelashes. She took it in stride. Mildly amused. I, however, was overcome with shame. I couldn't stand it that another person knew my secret. The next time she was out of the house, I sold my books and I rode a Greyhound bus 72 hours to the other end of the country. I never finished my PhD, and I've always regretted that. But what I regret even more is all these years I've continued to be ashamed of who I am, hiding it from everybody. Until now. I've started talking about my non-binary nature with family and close friends, and now all you nice people. My feminine side no longer has to be afraid of revealing herself. I'm still Jack, but I'm also Sarah. Hello.
Some bard singing about it. Come ye masters of war, you who build the best place, you who build the wrong, you who hide behind desks, you who hide heart of all. fit the battle of Jericho, and the walls came tumbling down. Onward, Christian soldier, marching. Yankee Doodle went to town, riding on a pony. We'll give her a hearty welcome and hurrah. Follow the drinking horn. Follow the drinking horn. For the old man is coming for to carry us to freedom. Virgil Cade is my name, and I serve on the temple train.
Hi, I'm Mark, And I want to tell you a little story about Barbara. I've been thinking about death lately, but oddly in a happy way. I was the youngest of four children, three of whom survived. I adored my older sisters who worshipped me and spoiled me rotten from the day I was born. And while I never knew Barbara, the oldest of our siblings, my mother told me that she was always watching over the whole family. And in these blessed years of my life, I've come to believe it more every day. Who do you want to meet when you die? You? You? I can't wait to meet Barbara. Is she going to be a day-old infant? Or a high school senior and I'll be a sixth grade nerd? Or maybe we're going to be contented senior citizens who enjoy each other's company and rock in heavenly rockers on the front porch of that Southwest Philadelphia home where I was born. Now, to fill Barbara's place, it took a small cadre of my sister Kathy's girlfriends. I was born just as she was beginning first grade at Most Blessed Sacrament, and I was pushed in my carriage every day by my mother on our way to and from school as she accompanied her. Six first graders in that initial class bonded immediately, and they remain friends for life.
Wow.
And I became their mascot, which gave me five new older sisters. And while it took all of them, Sally, Roe, Helen, Judy, and Andrea, who watched the show today from Pennsylvania on the stream. I thank Barbara for adjusting those stars in my favor. Thank you.
My name is Tara, and the title of my presentation is Another Transition. Transitions, we all have them. Recently, we just went through one, 2022, here we are. Transitions can be from conscious choices, or like when a rock hits the windshield, and as the crack grows, your vision blurs. Rocks have hit the windshield of my awareness numerous times. And the shock and emotional turmoil that I experienced were bouts of amnesia, forgetting that I had survived each time despite my fears. 27 years ago, I began anew as a psychotherapist. From my renewed self, I watched family members grow, marry, and move away. And then my only sibling, my dear brother, my champion, dropped dead at 47 of a heart-related issue. He left behind three young children, a loving wife, and a gaping hole in my heart. That was by far my most difficult transition to accept. Several years later, my father's avocado grove and our childhood home became my inheritance. After 3 years of transforming grove and house, I moved into my adobe home, renewed from our familial dysfunction. I wore two hats then. I really enjoyed my time there. I lived there for 1 year, and then the Witch Creek fire consumed it and everything surrounding it. "Why me?" I wailed as I walked among the skeletons left behind, convinced I was being punished by God for some irrational reason. I moaned and begrudged my fate. Once again, getting through this difficult transition was made possible through the love and support of friends, family, and my higher power. Seems to be the way through difficult transitions. Moving from the country, I let go of farming, settled into suburbia, and continued my practice. Who knew such a difficult transition could start out so traumatically and end up being so sweet? As time passed, so did friends and members of my large extended family. More transitions. 2021 brought an end to a significant chapter in my life as I stepped across a new threshold towards retirement. Saying goodbye to cherished clients, dear colleagues, and 20 years in my cottage office, I struggled to let go, dismantling and clearing the space for its next life. I really wasn't ready. Shedding tears and more tears, I wrestled with my core resistance and doubted my decision. Will they be okay? Did I do a good enough job? Will they have enough to support me? Will I be okay? What? Trust me, I heard one night above my sobs. I have been the sacrificial lamb, my suffering self-imposed. But what will become of all that love I shared with others? Is it possible I can love myself with that same force? Rest with a calm mind? Digesting the stillness of each moment I no longer need to fill? Lured from the cave of my blinded perceptions, the light draws me near its source. Love. Ah, change truly is a daily fare. Well, I don't need this anymore. My daytimer and all the obligations that you represented, I'm done with you. And my briefcase, well, you served me well, but I don't think I need you anymore. But wait, after you're done, my heart. I can't go without my heart. We belong together. Yes, I need you. You're coming with me. I think I did the best I could. Yeah, I did the best I could. I did a good enough job. I did the best I could. I'm going to be all right.
Thank you. let's say hi to the camera.
The Nazis invaded Croatia in 1941. My parents, they started rounding up the Jews to send them to Auschwitz. My parents escaped to Italy, and they left me with my aunt and my Catholic uncle. And I lived for 2 years like your good Catholic boy. Until one evening they arrested me. But my uncle was lucky to get me out 6 hours before the transport left for Auschwitz. And then he found a lady that was able to take me to Italy, to my parents, where we actually were freed by the Allies at the end of the war.
Wow. Well, you know, traumatic memories can remain repressed for years and suddenly resurface sometimes under stress, as in your case.
So what do we do now?
It would be helpful to revisit these experiences. Please retell your story and try to remember and share what you were feeling as it happened.
Okay, well, one evening I was just arrested.
Wait, Lubo, please, what were you feeling when the police arrived? What was going through your mind?
Let me think. There was a knock on the door. Who is it? Police. What? They want to arrest me? I'm just a child. No. I don't want to go. I don't want to have my head shaven. Don't shave my head, please. Please don't take me away. Open the door! Let me out! Mom!
Why did you leave me?
There's music. Procession. Oh, I was supposed to be there. My cousin Greta and I were supposed to march in the procession. Oh, let me see. There's the procession. There's Greta. Oh my God, she sees me. There are tears, she's crying. There are tears streaming down her cheeks. Greta!
Lubo, you survived.
Greta! I'm free!
This is called What Goldie Taught Me About Life, Laughter, and Death. When I was 8 years old, I saved my allowance to buy a goldfish. My mother dropped me off at Gertz, a five-story department store that was a cross between Mervyn's and Macy's, but a little Jewier. It had a beautiful and extensive selection of bar and bar mitzvah gifts. So I got in the elevator, pressed fifth floor, fish and exotic reptiles, and I bought my goldfish from a woman with no lips. She put Goldie in a plastic bag, tied a knot, and sent me on my way. But as the elevator was going down, Goldie was going up. By the time I got to the ground floor, Goldie was doing the dead fish float. I was devastated. I immediately got back in the elevator, pressed fifth floor, and showed Miss No Lips dead Goldie. She reluctantly gave me Goldie number two and sent me on my way. Well, Goldie number two lived a long and healthy life. About 8.5 months. And when Goldie passed away, my father, mother, three siblings, and I gathered around the toilet and flushed Goldie off to sewer heaven. And as I've gotten older, I realized that death is a part of life. When I was younger, I thought there was an order to death. Great-grandparents, grandparents, parents, ex-spouses. But then in 1998, my sister Ronnie called and said my cousin Ricky, who was living in Texas and was like a brother to me, had dropped dead from a virus to the heart. Ricky was gay, but when I told people that Ricky was gay, I found myself immediately saying how he died, because ignorant people assumed at that time that Ricky had died from AIDS. My Uncle Joe, Ricky's father, said he'd rather find out that he had cancer than to find out that his son was gay. Well, my Uncle Joe was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer and died within 5 days. So I flew to Houston to bury Ricky and to honor him. When I was giving his eulogy, I said that even when Ricky and I argued, we always ended our conversations with, "I love you." In 1999, I was finally divorced. Thank you. And as I was cooking dinner for my son Alexander and my daughter Emily, the phone rang. It was my Aunt Isabel, and she said, "Barbara died." Barbara, who was living in West Palm Beach at the time and was my best friend in the whole world. She was leaving the elementary school where she was teaching, and her car was struck by an 18-wheeler. She died instantly. I flew to Florida to bury Barbara and to honor her. Barbara was living in an apartment that was owned by my former in-laws, Hannah and Irving, for tax purposes. My former husband and I had lived there for a while too. So I was the only one who knew what belonged to whom. Lucky me. At the funeral, I told everyone how Barbara and I always told each other we loved each other. And then at one point I said, Barbara, Ricky's looking down at us and saying, how could you wear those shoes with that dress? Even the rabbi laughed. On October 18th, 2021, my mother-in-law Eve passed away at the ripe old age of 107.
Wow.
Amazing. Until the day she died, she remembered everything. Plots of movies, titles of books, lyrics to songs, the people who never called or visited her enough, the people who didn't spend enough money on her. And even though I always told her I loved her, she wasn't there for me. And I was stuck with a mother-in-law that I thought hated me. And I didn't know how to feel, and I didn't know what to do. But on the day she died, she looked at me and she said, I'm so proud of you, and I love you like a daughter. And I'm so happy that your son, my son, and you found each other. So it turned out I was wrong. I looked at her and I said, now you tell me on the day you're dying? And we laughed and laughed. And then I helped her let go. And we said our goodbyes. And it was at that moment that I realized that sometimes in life and death, laughter is what you need to do. In Yiddish, I had to throw in a little Yiddish. In Yiddish, the word shtuk means to make love. It does. Everybody repeat shtuk. Okay. My grandpa Max always said he wanted the following on my grandma Yetta's headstone. Yetta Resnick, the best shtuk in Kiev. On my headstone, it'll probably say, now you visit me? Did you bring any snacks? A little Entenmann's or something? Over the years, I have lost a sibling, parents, friends, dogs. But I do know the people that I lost. They all knew how much I loved them. And I knew how much they loved me. Because we told each other. Looking back, I know what got me through. It was the memories of laughing that pulled me out. For my cousin Ricky, it was the memories of Ricky and I mocking our family that pulled me out. For Barbara, it was when I was going through the things in her apartment and I found her diaphragm in Hannah's Passover tablecloth. And for Goldie One, it was that express train that to Goldfish Heaven that pulled me out. You know, in life, when I think back, death is difficult. And I remember when I was younger, and death was just a flush away. But I've also learned that life is short. And you never know whether you're going to have 107 years together or just a short elevator trip. But here's to laughing the whole way down, and here's to you, Goldie.
I have something to say. For as long as I can remember,
those five words had been playing in the back of my mind like a goddamn broken record. I'm Jerry. The story is titled James Francis. I have something to say. My oldest brother, James Francis, attended my parents' wedding as an 8-week-old embryo. My father once told him he wished he'd never been born. I have something to say. When Jim was about 15 years old, he took it upon himself to prepare dinner for the entire family. I welcome you into our small rental home on Colfax Street in small town Midwest, USA. It was Sunday and we had returned from 10:30 Mass at St. Mary's Catholic Church. Jim came from the kitchen carrying a bright white ceramic pot with enough hot dogs to feed our family of eight. He announced, "Let's eat," and we all came to the dining room table. Shortly into the meal, my father rose and started pointing his finger at Jim and scolding him. I don't remember the words, I tuned them out. What happened? Was it because Jim served dinner before Dad was finished with his beer? Mom would always ask. Was it because prior to this, Jim wrote my father a note asking him to please stop sexually molesting our sister, Barb? My father stormed out of the house to one of his favorite bars. Jim sat there, crying, sobbing, saying he doesn't love me. We all just sat there. We all just sat there. I was here, and Barb and Mom. Mom, your oldest child is calling out to you. Why can't you go to him? And Dave and Rick and Brian all sat there, hanging their heads in shame. I have something to say. Jim was bullied for most of his life. His nickname in high school was Puppet. He would entertain anybody that pulled his strings. In our small bedroom that slept five, he had set up an altar. He would light a candle and pray to the Virgin Mary for his anguish to be ended. I have something to say. My brother Jim died at the age of 45. His third heart surgery was not successful. How ironic that he should die of a broken heart. Two parents, five siblings, all in some way abandoned him. He was never loved. I went to see him in the ICU where only yesterday he was struggling to stay alive. The room was eerily quiet. The sound of life support systems was silent. The puppet strings turned IV tubes were gone. His anguish had ended. He looked so peaceful, so content. A part of me was happy for him. He was lying on a table with a bright white sheet pulled up to his chest. I leaned over, kissed him on the forehead, and said goodbye. I have one last thing to say. A fund has been set up in Jim's name, the James Francis Fund. I'm proud to see his name displayed in the cabaret and on the arm of seat D2. It will support theater that tells his story and keeps his memory alive.
Hi again. It's me, Sarah. I'd like to sing for you one of my favorite songs. Mm-hmm.
I need to get in heaven. Hard to live. Your mind begins to wander. Things start to drift. Your arms are getting heavy. Hard to lift. Sink down a little deeper. You're feeling wonderful. Feeling wonderful. Maybe you're falling in love. Maybe you're falling in love. Maybe you're falling, 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 falling in love. Stare across the harbor. Lights along the bay. Arms have got so heavy now. They're just getting in your way. Look, now you're walking in the Holy Land. Yeah, that's you there, walking with the King. You ask, what have I done to deserve? Well, you haven't done a thing. Maybe you're falling in love. Maybe you're falling in love. Maybe you're falling, 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 falling in love. Maybe you're falling in love. Maybe you're falling in love. Maybe you're falling, 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 falling in love.
Them to think you're a woman. You could do way better. Lose the beard. Put in some padding. A lot more convincing.
I'm not sure about being convincing. I think it makes these people nervous and then they get uncomfortable.
These people here, they're okay with it. But out there, I know, it does make them confused and uncomfortable. They're the people I've been hiding from. But I'm done hiding from them and from myself. You have a different reason for wearing a dress. Tell us.
Okay, Sarah. Many years ago, my sister Kathy was approaching her 60th birthday, and my brother-in-law promised her a terrific party as long as he didn't have to attend. Thus was born the all-girl party. Every female relative and friend was invited, including five of my sister's girlfriends that she had known since first grade. I talked to my Aunt Jeannie that week or week before, and she was lamenting that I wouldn't be there for the party, and I said, they don't want me there anyway because it's an all-girl party, and we laughed. I went in and told my husband that, and he said, why not? And why not? The 21st century had begun. I was a paid-up member of AARP. And as a gay male, I knew that I had gender fluidity in my DNA. So I packed a bag with a dress, a wig, shoes, and on the way to their house, I made a long distance call to my sister on my cell phone, wished her a happy birthday, told her to give my love to all of the ladies who would be in attendance, and especially my five girlfriends from Most Blessed Sacrament. So I arrived at her house shortly after she departed, threw on the dress, wig, and shoes, a little bit of makeup, and jumped into my brother-in-law's car, and he drove me to the site of the party. And I just have to tell you at this point, I love my brother-in-law. He was my sole co-conspirator. So my arrival set off rounds of gasps, laughter, confusion. My other sister had no idea who I was. And I was overjoyed that I had rocked this party like no other would be. Because you see, Kathy was the oldest of the girls, and it meant it was the beginning of a series of 60th birthday parties. And by the year end, hers was voted absolutely the very best, thanks to the insane, glorious love with which her gay little brother wanted to shower her. So I guess there are different reasons for men to wear a dress. You are allowing your femme side to blossom. And I wanted to comically shower my sibling with love.
Well, how wonderful to have a group of five honorary sisters.
Wouldn't mind having another. Would you like to join?
I'd be delighted.
Who comes between me and my sister? And Lord help the sister who comes between me and my man.
Cantankerous spreadsheets and distressed customers to earn the fine comforts afforded me now. Now, my vessel in a cozy slip in this marina. My shape, though, tis not ship shape. A 10-pound sack of potatoes on my frame doth ne'er get me too much paunchy, gut-griping hashtag. Also under scrutiny now, lines and wrinkles hither and yon. Fie! What gleeking propaganda hath manipulated me? Cruel iPhone apps that tell an untrue story. Mangled, ill-natured minnow. I dare say, as a 21st century woman, unconditional self-love is a struggle. Yet, have I found in my husband's eyes over 30 years desire. Steady, sweet, and true. His adoration rises above the noise. My skin, though soft to the touch, beckons for oils, lotions, polishing, and he doth daily, from bow to stern, rub my rails with slippery coconut oil. This he conducts with the kindest of fingers, with the touch of a musician who does play a happy tune upon my instrument. Leisurely, lovingly, delighting senses, causing stirrings that were in the time of menopause lost, then gone. A cold and desolate time for both of us, for I could not stand thee. Thou wert a befuddled, barnacle-bitten blowhard, and I a yeasty, weeping cormorant. Nay, we did not arrive at this port without a bevy of remedies, including estrogen. And wise counsel from my circle of women. 'Tis true, thy honey tongue doth flatter me, like a plume of peacock feathers to my inviting peahen. So in this time of folly, when there is pickleball, paddleboarding, and museums, thou hath ignited in me desires and longings, once a fond memory. Nay! For these sweet delights are even more potent than one could behold in youth. Though I craved in thee a manager of sorts, that was not thy best role. Thou art indeed my muse, my capable captain, silly jester, and doting lover. Improvising with me for pleasure or play, for thee, I am Lucille Ball and Beyoncé. Thou hast me riding on thy surfboard. I, your blushing lady, you, my faithful lord, in this sacred place, this divine bark, upon unencumbered waters we embark. A frothy wave come over us both, and we are tossed, and for blissful moments are we lost. In these golden days, you make me swoon. In this beloved retirement, honeymoon.
Begins at 10 o'clock a.m. Bring a towel and please stay in the shallow end of the pool. Remember what happened to dear Mr. Lewis. He will be missed.
There's a moment you know you're fucked. Room to self-destruct. No more moves, oh yeah, the dead end zone. just can't call your soul your own.
But what really will make you jump is that the weirdest shit is yet to come. You may ask, what have I done? You're just a fly, the little guys they kill for fun.
And you're fucked if you just freeze up. Can't do that thing that keeping still. But you're fucked if you speak your mind. And you know how hard we will.
Bundled up into